So what I'm going to do is I'm going to start off with asking each of the panelists to introduce themselves so you get to know who they are directly from them. So Roziah, please.
Yeah, hi. Very good morning to everyone. My name is Sharifah Roziah Mohd Kassim. It's a very long name. Yeah. Okay, I'm from AfricaCERT. AfricaCERT is a Malaysia Computer Emergency Response Team, and the parent company is Cybersecurity Malaysia. And I'm doing incident response for my company. And basically, we are doing it for the Malaysian constituency. Any attacks or any malicious activities coming from Malaysian IPs, we are responsible for that. Thank you.
Thank you. Thomas.
I'm Tom Millar. I've been with AfricaCERT at Homeland Security since 2007. And I'm currently on detail as a technical advisor to our nominee for the undersecretary position for the National Protection Programs Directorate. I've done every odd job around the AfricaCERT hallways except for malware reverse engineering. And I'm a watch officer, vulnerability coordination manager, and communications chief for quite a while.
Jean Robert.
My name is Jean Robert Hountomey. I come from an organization which is a regional organization covering the African continent, providing framework and platform for different stakeholders to get together and coordinate incident response activities. So I cover different range of activities for that organization. And on the other side, I am also a product security lead for a vendor. Thank you.
Thank you. And my name is Peter Allor. I'm the chair for the Education Advisory Board underneath the Forum for Incident Response and Security Teams. Somehow I let myself be talked into that when I left the board of directors. So I was asked to help put together this panel. Actually, the board helped me with the panel, and I thought they did a great selection of speakers because of the wide variance we have here. In my daytime job, I actually work for Honeywell International. I take care of, I'm a chief security officer for our connected enterprises. So that's who we are. Let's talk first a little bit about what is FIRST. FIRST actually was founded back in 1990, shortly after CERT CC, and the work that they did with a lot of other entities like DOE, et cetera, regarding the Morris worm. And the question then was, how do we as incident responders work together? And we're a pretty small group, about 184 teams up through 2010. And we changed our focus. We have teams from academia, from government, from vendors, from enterprises on six continents. And it says 409 teams. I think we actually had a few admittances. We're closer to 460 teams. And a team has to be organized, actually has to have a construct that is from their parent organization that says that's your mission, and you have budget, and you have authority. And so then you have to go through a vetting process to show that you actually understand incident response, you can communicate securely, and that you have a written process. For those of us in the incident response community, we look at being a member of FIRST to be really the first stage to being acknowledged as an incident response team. Now, note that we cover both product security and computer security. And we'll talk about that some more as we go forward. So that's our mission, really, is to talk about incident response and educate people and bring them into the fold. And when we did our services framework, it was about how do we actually own our own destiny? How do we describe who we are before some ISO body or IETF or some other standard says, here's how you ought to do it, and hasn't practiced. And we did the same for our legislative brethren, because they have great ideas. They just don't work so well on paper. So we wanted to own that. So as we did that, we came up with first the CCERT services framework. To me, it's a bit of a paperweight. It's almost 90 pages long. And it's a selection of all the services that a broad community set of CCERTs would do. Notice that's a plural. It doesn't mean every CCERT, in fact, does that. When we completed that work, which took nearly 2 years, had input from 35 national CERTs, as well as members from private sector and information sharing organizations. So there's a lot of work there. When we went to the PCERT, we were smarter the second time around. You always are when you write a document a second time. We followed the same format. But one of the things we recognized was that a product security incident response team is wholly different from a computer security incident response team. We do the same things, kind of. When I say that, we then had to come up with what's a way to articulate that difference. And if you went and read the document, you would find that in our briefing materials, we talked about the NIST cybersecurity framework as a Rosetta Stone to show the differences between both sides. And there's overlap, and yet there's areas of concentration. And they all fit, believe it or not, within that framework. And if you really look at the NIST cybersecurity framework, it's really a redo of COBIT. So we all do it. The question is, are we formalized in articulating what we do? Because as incident response, many times our problem is telling management why we need to exist and why we need a resource and why we need to do certain processes to coordinate. And as we go through that, we've learned other things that don't work very well, and that is we haven't described maturity. And we're going to talk a little bit about that. So the key here is if you come up with something like that, there are 400 and some odd teams in FIRST. My question is, how many incident response teams are there really out there? And when you look at it, the number of incident response teams should be in the millions. I think we all agree that there needs to be more. If you're producing code, you probably should have a PCERT type organization. If you're protecting your organization's domain, you should probably have a computer incident response. So what do you do? And so what we do is we look to inform the incident response world. And we realize that's not a single touch point. And so we're developing training to go and help educate. But that's not the only place we do it. And as you listen to the panelists, you're going to see that while we might have a common approach, we also recognize that sometimes there's regional and or organizational differences. So we're going to talk to some of the capacity building elements, but we're not limiting our discussion today about capacity. Because quite honestly, if you ask Tom and I, we'd probably have a slightly different definition of capacity. But if you listen to the underlying words, while we're trying to come at it slightly differently, we have the same objectives. And that, to us, is how we work as incident responders. Because many times in an incident, you're going to reach out and talk to someone, and many of us do in the first community with each other, and say, I need help. And understanding where the other guy's coming from makes it so much easier and faster to solve a problem, or at least move to the next stage. So with that in mind, let's talk about the type of themes that we're going to talk about today. And I'm going to encourage you not to wait for a Q&A period. You have a question on any one of these subjects or anything about incident response? Well, we're going to give you an all-comers call. You can ask at any time. And if you don't, we'll move our way through this list of things to talk about. So there's trusted exchanges, and I'm going to ask each of the panelists to talk to that. They'll talk about the regional part. We'll talk about there are problems, workforce, and why we think this helps you, I won't say shortcut it, but address a process that you don't need the initial workforce to create whole cloth. How do I do it? You'll need something to sustain it, but then you'll have a baseline on which to say, this is what the rest of the world is doing, and believe me, I've been doing that inside Honeywell. So that's what we have to work through. And so you use these processes there. So almost reverse down the table here, and I'm going to start with Jean Robert. And Jean Robert, you do a lot of work across a couple different organizations, but in this case, you're talking a lot more from the AfricaCERT. Why don't you talk about how you work through some of these themes about trust, vertical industries, and how do you train for soft skills?
Thank you. Thank you. So our story is a little bit tied to what happened and the way FIRST was founded. A couple of people gathered together starting to discuss about how to respond to the different abuse they were facing online. And then in 2009-2010, we faced the conflict worm issue and had to reach out to FIRST and ICANN. for coordinated response around the continent. So that was the start of putting together an organization with different members at different stage of their maturity level to be able to put all the stakeholders together and provide coordinated response. So the organization has been evolving, facing, depending on the issue that it has been facing. So today we recognize that besides the incident response team that have been put in place, there was a need to engage some different trusted party like security professional, security researcher, as a level of membership in the organization, but also organization that at this time doesn't have yet incident response capability, but are putting product and services online. And among them, you have CCTLDs, registrars, internet exchange points, ISPs, research and education network. So the idea was to provide a platform for everybody to come together to discuss the challenges and provide a response. We moved further in that model by engaging other organizations like the law enforcement community as a special type of membership, but also organizations like Internet Society, ICANN, MOG, etc., in a way that we wanted to be able to build a database of trusted people that can be reached out to in case there is an issue. And we work in a framework that has five principles. The principle number one is that we want to have a common language. We call it standardization, common language, common understanding of things. The second principle is that we want all the members to be transparent and build a trusted relationship between one another. The third principle, we call it collective responsibility. So we want everyone to work responsibly between all the different organizations and to be responsible for what you put online. And the fourth principle is sustainability. If you say you do something, we want you to be able to provide that level of services or that something that you do consistently in the community. And the five principle is what we call think global and act local, which is also a way to put the different stakeholders together. So surprisingly, when we started the operation, we were meant to be a forum. But quickly, we start being, the organization start being engaged by members at the horizontal level, but also at the vertical level in responding to incident and connecting people together. To give you an example, so we started late 2012, 2013, and engaged right away with FIRST, trying to build capacity and activity together. In 2014, the organization received, at least we opened about 17,000 tickets related to incident and requests for connection and activities. In 2015, we opened about 7,400 tickets. In 2016, we opened about 8,070 tickets. And in 2017, we opened about 6,500 tickets. That tells us that focusing on few stakeholders what we would like to call initially incident response team is good, but we have to move beyond that level and engage anyone that puts something online to be more effective together. So I will stop there and come back later describing how we build capacity, workforce, and et cetera, to give chance to others to.
I want to remind my panel to come with shorter answers, but that's okay.
He had a lot to cover.
He did. There's a lot he packed in there.
I don't think any of the rest of us have a whole continent.
I'm going to challenge you that on Roziah. You actually cover two different regional concerns of incident response. Would you describe both of them for us?
Okay. Malaysia, we are actually located in Southeast Asia, and we sit, in fact, not two, three. We have the ASEAN region, which is the Southeast Asian Forum. We have the OIC, which is the Organization of Islamic Countries, and we have AfricaCERT, which is Asia Pacific CERT. So we work very close with the three of these communities on incident response, because I think we know that incidents are not happening within a particular domain. It crossed the border, right? So we cannot handle it on our own. We need a cooperation, we need a collaboration with other parties. So what we do is that within Asia Pacific, we work very close with the other CERTs, for example, Japan, China, Korea. So we work in terms of information exchange and threat information exchange. And if there is any particular threat that is happening within, for example, in the Asia-Pac region, we quickly alert each other about this threat so that we can identify the root cause and we try to fix the problem. The same goes for the OIC CERT and also the ASEAN region. So Malaysia, we have been doing incident response for the past 20 years. We just celebrated our birthday last month. Our 20th birthday. So, and in Asia-Pac, we are one of the third countries after Australia and Japan. So, we have the mature teams and also the less mature teams within the region. So what we do is that the mature teams, we offer some kind of trainings and assistance on incident response so that we learn each other about the current threats, what are the tools and expertise that we need in identifying and resolving incidents.
So I heard a theme already of mature and less mature and starting teams there and assistance. Tom, how's that work for AfricaCERT? Because to your point, you don't have a continent, and Roziah showed basically the Asia Pacific region with all the Islamic world. What's the maturity like in the U.S., and why aren't we there? I threw him under the bus.
Way to drag on your home country, Pete. So one of the issues that we have in the United States is that we built the internet, and we have everybody else has got a green fields kind of thing. Like, hey, you know what? Great idea. I'm going to do it just a little bit better because I might be 10 years behind, but I can make different investments than you did. And we have a mess, right? Our attacks, I frequently said this, my capacity building starts at home. From a State Department perspective, that's a non-starter. I understand that, but that's okay. We have funding too. But we want to reduce the attack surface here domestically. And then I want to be able to use that as a way I go out and, you know, show credibility to partners around the world. Like, BCP38's not that hard, right? If you want to, you know, get rid of all the spoofed traffic that contributes significantly to the, you know, DDoS problem, you know, here's a way to do it. I would love to be able to say, like, I worked with all my tier one ISPs and I did this and I did that. And then other people can say, like, oh, well, if they can do it, I can do it too. And I used to say, like, basically, like, if there's anything that we could agree upon in a bilateral with our Chinese colleagues, it would be like, let's just reduce the global attack surface between you and me, the IP space and the bandwidth. If US and China got together and said BCP 38 is going to be a thing, like, that would be pretty significant. So capacity building for me starts out being like, yes, work with the highly mature teams, the other people who are advancing the state of the practice, like CERT Malaysia and JP CERT in Japan, and say, like, okay, let's make some tools and work together and have some awesome stuff that's all automated and takes care of all the problems. But back to the capacity building at home, I also realized we still have a real people problem. To the fourth bullet on Pete's slide up here.
The race to the top.
I have one of these anecdotes that's I share all the time with people, that I went to a Source Boston conference, and I ran into a fellow from a major retailer in the US. And I didn't know what a major retailer was doing at a Source conference in Boston. I always thought that was for hackers or something. I was like, what are you guys up to? And he's like, recruiting, man. I'm like, really? So, like, recruiting, you know, like, he's like, well, you know, we got to find him somewhere, and you guys kind of priced us out of the market. I'm like, I'm a Fed. Like, how did I price you out of the market? That's crazy talk. You're private sector. You're always supposed to be able to pay people more. And then I'd start to think about it and realize that the guy who has keys to 17 stores in the tri-state region or whatever, and worked for the company for 25 years and has put his time in, he makes about what I'll pay a 23-year-old, you know, to come and work for me in DC and you know, crack down on malware and whatnot, because I'm, you know, it's a very specific set of I have a very particular set of skills, but it is, it's a we have a real labor market problem. And I on the one hand, I know it's BS whenever a company pays a research firm or a consultancy to come out with a report that always ends in a big round number with lots of zeros. But the Cisco report from a couple years ago, that said we're about 1 million jobs short, or as you said, we should have a million certs around the world, that sounds about right to me. I think it might be low. So we need to professionalize, we need to formalize education, our curriculum guidance has to get better, and we need to start tiering this stuff too. Because to the maturity model point that I think Peter is trying to get me to talk about, I don't need PhDs to do all this work. There's plenty of that to go around at this point. I need people who are going to turn the wrench every day, in and out. When the patches get shipped, you put the patches on, right? I need people who are going to deploy the thing. Like 3-4 years ago in Boston, I talked about this. This means, like, if we're going to really change the state of the game, it's going to take a different category of person than is currently doing this. Because we're all a bunch of self-selected MacGyver types. If you give us the same problem twice, we're gonna solve it differently the second time because we're easily bored. And sometimes I just need people who show up at the same time every morning and follow procedures. And that's what's going to actually, like, I think we need a different type of person than we're used to recruiting. And so, okay, so education, curriculum guidance, and it all starts at home. If we can't show, as the United States and the Department of Homeland Security, if we can't show that we're making a real difference in the attack and reflection surface and the vulnerabilities that we have here, then how do I go to AP CERT and say, oh, this is what you ought to be doing?
So I heard this theme still. Everyone has a maturity level and an awareness level for having instant response. There's immature teams, those who are trying to learn. And that's not to call them that they have a lack of desire, it's just a matter of they have a lack of experience or process. We have mature teams who have process, they have experience, but as Tom pointed out, we have young people who want to be the top, and quite honestly, a lot of our job is about making sure that process and checklists are followed. And that grates a lot of people who are a little bit senior up in the chain of events. And we have a work shortage problem set. So part of what our idea is, let's help people get to that and understand how to overcome that, because it's a basic blocking and tackling. And I heard an element that Tom added was it's really an individual problem. And unfortunately, most people at computers like a light switch. So Jean-Robert, how does the lack of a workforce affect how you approach this? And how do you facilitate retaining them?
So I think that we are probably most of the people affected by the lack of workforce. And the way we are doing it is based on three principles. The first one is to push people to learn the fundamentals. I'm joining a little bit Thomas here, which means for me, or for us, people focus on learning things like RFCs, drafts, senders, so that we can have hand skill people to respond to issue, but also a common dialogue between one another. That's the first thing. The second thing that we have been doing, because the main point is within a resource constrained environment, it is to identify people like FIRST. Tom talked about it, Pete enforces it, and Roziah as well, to identify people that can provide assistance, training, capacity building with material. So we've been reaching out to FIRST and different organizations, MOG, even Internet Society and ICANN, where we can find content that can be used to give people the level of skills that they need to respond to daily challenge. And the third approach that we have been doing is that notion of train of trainer. I like to joke saying that the TTL, time to leave, for an engineer is 6 months. As soon as he gets good, 6 months to 2 years, he's gone with other adventure. So we've been engineering ways to make those people contribute, even if they are not anymore at their current position. So that's pretty much what we have been doing to address the education and capacity building area.
So I'm going to go to Razir in just a moment. But one of the things that I wanted to highlight is he talked about going to ICANN. You named, I think, three
Internet
other standards.
Internet Society, bodies. Yeah. MOG.
You'll find that the community is very involved in these various elements. And if you're looking for how do you make those better, the best way is to play. And like I mentioned about the best practices that we put together for instant response, but most people don't realize that we actually help write and bring to bear the ISO 3011 on incident handling and 29174 on incident response, because we live those. And so we have to be part of that. And that's where we're trying to actually talk. We're talking here between individual, regional, and we're touching real lightly the organizational, but the key is how do you show your organization that you have this? So that's one of the things, Razir, if you can talk to a little bit of how do you help a team become more mature?
Okay, yeah. How to make a team more mature is that I think facilitation is very important. Yeah, facilitation. Yeah, to make new teams to become more mature, we need to facilitate them, give them education, trainings, and experience that they need. And of course, we need to give them exposure in incident response. That is very crucial. In fact, we in Malaysia CERT particularly, we are very much involved in recruiting new teams and developing them into a more mature team. For example, we had done for like Myanmar CERT, we had done for Cambodia CERT, to name a few. And we had also assisted CERTs in the Middle East region, such as Tunisia CERT and also Egypt. We had assisted them. And I would not say that they are completely mature, but they are, on the way to becoming a more mature team. So I believe facilitation is very important in order to develop these teams into a more mature team. And I think, that's where the regional cooperation and first comes into the picture. In that, we have to work together to facilitate these teams and, you know, groom them to become a more mature team. So the responsibility is, of course, on the more mature teams, try to bring these less mature teams, you know, to move forward to be on par with the more mature teams.
To just ask quickly something that you said, Roziah. So those teams that we have been helping, they are now helping other teams in the African continent to get back to status.
Yeah.
Thank you for that.
yeah. That's why I say that it's a global. You know, it's a global. That, you know, when we assist a team to become more mature, right. So it's their responsibility to assist the other teams, the other less mature teams. So in fact, we are not working like, you know, in a silo or something like that. We work together. We have the OIC CERT, we have the AP CERT, and of course we have FIRST. So we move, you know, within this community in grooming teams to become more mature.
Go ahead, Tom.
So I want to level set with the audience, because I think we're using some acronyms that we didn't expand properly for everybody here. Messaging Mobile Malware Anti-Abuse Working Group. Who knows what that is? Mohd? Mohd? Okay. We have a Mohd. We have a guy who knows Mohd. Probably a member, hopefully. Anti-Phishing Working Group, APWG. Who's into that?
Okay.
A few more.
Forum for Incident Response and Security Teams that Pete already described, because that's the whole point of this panel. Okay. And then we said ISO, IAC. Right, we go to our standards bodies, or I call them the I-STARS, ICANN, Internet Society, IETF, IANA, et cetera. And then OIC CERT, Organization of Islamic Countries,
yes.
CERT.
Yes.
You talked about AP CERT. So I read a book one time in grad school that said collaboration was actually a very expensive activity. Turns out that was true. It takes money, resources, and a lot of calories to put people downrange. We were discussing how long our flights are. And you, like I was telling, later this year I get to go to, maybe I'll get to go to Kuala Lumpur, and I'm really looking forward to it, but that requires crossing both the date line and the equator. That part's not fun. And that, like, you have to pick the people who are going to do that, and all this collaboration in person, it's really powerful, but it is a tremendous investment. And if you don't understand, like, if you don't know where to go and you don't know how to write the justification memorandum, it becomes very difficult for your team, and especially if you're already in that retailer's position where you can barely snipe talent from the government, for crying out loud. You know, that becomes very tough, and I think that's one of the challenges I want to start to address, is how do we start creating symposia forums to address that people problem domestically and regionally without costing as much as it does today? Because I think it's really important to be a participant in Anti-Phishing Working Group and Malware Mobile Malware Messaging, Anti-Abuse Working Group, which I think exists as a case study to prove that the government doesn't have a monopoly on terrible acronyms. So all of those things are really important to be part of, and they're really powerful places to do this, to facilitate and get this education that our you know, that we want all our teams to have. But again, this is like, how do I start to slowly reduce, or, you know, like,
yeah,
get the edges off the cost around that.
And Tom brought up, actually the three panelists brought it all up, but we didn't say it heavily. We have an annual conference, it lasts a week. If you go to some of the training sessions before, or if you attend the National CSERT thing afterwards, you have the potential to have about 10 straight days, about 750 people. So it's not small, but at the same time, you get introduced, usually about half the attendees are new, the others are recurrent. I've gone to 17 straight, I might miss this year, so I hate to break the record, but the whole idea is that you come and you hear both the individual stories and you hear the team stories. And what we're trying to focus on is a lot of individual, but also team you know, having something that your person can take back for the team to learn from is what we're really focusing towards more now. There's plenty of other certifications for the individual. And we don't just run a conference a year. We have symposia that usually organize around an industry. Healthcare, electric power, financial we leave alone because they do pretty good by themselves already. But then we had a two-day meeting in Atlanta this year for, it's our third recurring meeting annually, for PCERTs. So it's very focused on product security incident response because it was our problem and we have a trust network. And you notice that it's not to subdivide the entire community, it's a matter of saying, here's our niche within the community and how do we advance that? So as an organization, we're looking to increase that more and ask you, if you're interested, come attend. And just go to our website and do that, because this is how all of us really got started. And part of what we do, we select teams. We actually fund six teams per year. It's a six-year run. The first 2 years are gratis for them. That includes their membership. So you're finding teams are just starting. They have the aegis to go forward. They have the desire to go forward, but they need the means to get involved and ensure success. And move that forward. And that is a way that we've done that now. We're into fourth, going to the fifth year of bringing teams in. You know, as a nonprofit, that's good because we pay for those long haul expenses. But do get involved in those type things. So if you were to look at that, let's see, we have what, 7 minutes left? Timekeeper?
Questions?
Yes, that's where I was going.
Hello, Anne, Federal Reserve, New York. Throughout the conference, we've heard a lot of talking about, you know, resource demand, skill sets, and given the interesting international panel we have here, interested in how you're pursuing recruitment, talent development of women. I think about the book Half the Sky. How do we, or how are you expanding your reach to women?
Yeah, okay, I can say that in Malaysia, okay, the women, we are less involved in, you know, IT and engineering sector compared to men. And of course, we are really promoting, you know, more women into this cybersecurity and also engineering area. And if we look a bit broader, I think it's not just in Malaysia, it is in the Asia-Pac region. I think one of the things that deters is that maybe it's the cultural, you know, cultural norm that women in Asia-Pac, they're, you know, a bit less involved in technology and engineering field. We are, I think we are more inclined towards maybe a medicine or legal and all that. But we are really promoting women in cybersecurity and engineering. In fact, like in Cybersecurity Malaysia, we are working very closely with the local universities, you know, to have cybersecurity programs, like a master in cybersecurity. I'm also involved in some of the programs. I'm teaching some of the masters in cybersecurity, and it's good that we are seeing more and more women involved in the at the university level. Into these cybersecurity related courses, and we hope to see that when they graduate and you know they can come into the market and we can see more and more women in cybersecurity.
So to add quick to that, last year there was an initiative. So there are different organizations that we call the AFSTARS in the continent working together. So AfricaCERT, AFTLD, etc. Last year, a group started that is called AF Chicks, which is a group of women engineers getting together and picking up resources from all the other organizations to organize women around cyber-related issue.
What is it's called Chicks?
AF Chicks.
Oh. Wait, do you still want to hear my answer to the question?
No.
We promulgate role models. I believe there was somebody giving a keynote on Tuesday. Okay. also known as my grand boss, and she's pretty exceptional as far as I'm concerned. My assistant secretary, Jeanette Manfra, is also awesome. And actually met Girl Scouts USA, has the cyber pin now, mm-hmm. and met the CEO the other day. That was a fun little speaker's lounge moment. I was like, what? How did this happen? And in the federal government, you are required to hire the absolute best candidate for the job, regardless of race, gender, religion, anything, right? I do, however, give a lot of consideration when I go to job fairs and things like that, that I do want to try. I'm going to get in trouble for this, aren't I? I want my team to look like the general population, right? If I have, because my team has to focus on outreach, coordination, and talking to all people of all stripes around the world and in our industries at home and in critical infrastructure. And the more that we resemble the general population, the more we're going to have all the right types of folks to integrate with everyone, you know, that we have to talk to and have relationships with. And again, we don't have any regulatory or law enforcement authority in my part of the department. There's other levers that the secretary has and that, you know, the government as a whole has, but we have to cajole and we have to encourage and we have to get people to sort of like just trust us and like us and think that, well, if he says I ought to do this, then maybe I should consider it, right? The whole like BCP 38 and I don't want to be somebody who has to annoy you into doing the right thing. I want to say like, have you ever thought about this? And I want my team to all be able to do that too. And we can go out there and immediately and get that instant rapport that sometimes comes from being the same kind of person that your customer is or your constituent is, then that's incredibly valuable for building trust, for building relationships. And back once more, I'll say, the category of people that have been doing this job for the last 30 years since the Morris worm are not necessarily the category of people that are going to solve the next 30 years, right?
That's very true.
More inclusive, we have to be inclusive, and we have to get more diverse.
So from a corporate level, I'll just say this. Make sure they get into intern programs.
Word?
Intern, yeah. If they're not in there, that's just, that's where you're going to find your ability to really advance fast into cybersecurity. And we have, I'll say for the software center I work out of, we have a lot of women who are applying. We get them out of the tech schools, and they really do it. Time for one quick question.
So real quick, I know you hinted at it a little bit, but for team training, do you guys have any good resources for, you know, as an incident response manager to be able to say, okay, I got lots of training, all my guys are spot on by themselves, but how do you do a good job training a team?
The quick answer is we're in the process of developing some of that. We just put together some quick videos for the incident response stuff for PCERT. I know they're doing the same thing for the CCERT side. We have the first level, the high level of our stuff. We're developing the tier level below that. You actually do it by maturity level. We didn't really talk to all the maturity levels because some of us have 5, some of us have 3. But we are working to that level so you can actually select what you need for your team. So it's a retraining or it's initial training or you bring someone on new to be part of the team training. So we are working at, not fully there. Free. First.org. Okay.
And okay. I would say, wait.
I got to stop.
There's also the NICE framework. Does anybody know the NICE framework that NIST has been developing? And so if you go to NIST, National Institute for Standards and Technology, or just Google NICE framework, N-I-C-E, that actually gives you a lot of sort of like the curriculum guidance, training recommendations, and things like that.
Thank you all. Been a great audience. Appreciate you being here for early in the morning. Go get the other coffee.